great to be here. And I just want to acknowledge my colleague here, Mark Beard-Penning, who's the Professor of Social and Cultural Geography at the Otto Friedrich University in Bamberg in Bavaria, where much of this discussion will take place virtually. And I must also acknowledge that we have a tiny bit of funding from the Bavarian Research Alliance to do the work that, that I'm going to be talking about. And here we are, here's Bath, just down the road, and there's Bamberg. And I'm going to be talking about mainly Bamberg, actually, although we do talk a bit about Bath. And the reason that I'm going to concentrate on Bamberg is because I imagine that some of the issues around urban horticulture and alternative food networks might be familiar to us because Bath's really just down the road, but also because I really want to talk about culture as a facet of understanding urban horticulture, and that really comes out very clearly in the Bamberg example. So, let's see. So there's no need for this slide at all. There's only a few of us, so you know the main thing to say is, you know, I'll talk about both cities, but quickly get onto Bamberg. But the main thing is, please interrupt me at any time. You don't have to make it formal. Okay, so we can start with the literature, and one of the reasons that Mark and I were inspired to work together, really, was because a lot of the literature on urban agriculture and urban horticulture is very rich, it's relatively new as well, some of it. There's so much been going on in the last few years in scholarship and in practice about urban agriculture. And I just wanted to use this slide to draw out a few of the themes that we can recognise from that literature. There's a lot, isn't there, going on, particularly from practitioner groups like RUAF, who talk about urban agriculture as a way to increase household food security in the global south. And then my colleague, Damien May, has written a lot recently about smart growth and how food and urban agriculture fits into that, perhaps from a more technological point of view. And also the other thing that's quite noticeable about much of the literature linked to the Global South is that big cities are the subject of those studies. You know, Belo Horizonte, for example, and Cape Town, some famous examples. So, then we've also got the whole sustainability literature. You know, urban agriculture is both a process towards sustainability, it's a policy response towards enhancing sustainability. If you think about the old Agenda 21 framework, that really spurred many city councils to think about developing sustainable food policies in their cities, and famous ones in Europe, and Milan, Bristol, and London. Years and years ago, it seems, I was seconded to the Greater London Authority to try and establish the architecture for what's now London Food, the Mayor's Food Policy Council there. So sustainability is very much on the agenda when it comes to urban agriculture. And then we can also think about how we see urban agriculture as a functional phenomenon. So there's a lovely, really brilliant article, I think, by Ina Opitz and colleagues, who sort of divides urban agriculture into spatial domains. So on the edge of the city, the peri-urban sphere, that's where commercial agriculture happens. And it might be intensive and hopefully profitable. And the usual story that we recognise from commercial agriculture. Whereas in the urban envelope, in the city, that's not that, it's different. It's a social issue, social innovation, social cohesiveness, all that stuff. This is familiar to us.
Excuse me?
Yes.
Forgive my ignorance, they're used to me, because I'm not a social scientist. How then, if that's what you just said, how does that feed back into urban sustainability? If you were saying it's mainly a social benefit issue, how does that actually feed back into sustainability?
I suppose you could say that by engaging in those social food projects, one of the things that's been said often is that people's awareness of the environmental issues linked to food production and extended food chains, for example, is a particularly good example, is heightened. And people feel maybe more in touch with things like seasons, and there's usually there's an increase in the exchange of knowledge around growing, you know, practical knowledge around how you grow food.
So it's perhaps a bit more indirect and educational rather than
having
a direct.
That's right.
Contribute.
And I think what we're seeing as well, I'll come back to this a bit later now, is almost sustainability has been around for a long time as a term and maybe is very liberally interpreted. Mm-hmm. And I think what we're beginning to see now in sort of terms of urban landscapes and urban policy making and planning policy making is the idea of livable cities being talked about. And I think that does help to think about how the idea that you're involved in neighbourhood, community-led urban agriculture and horticulture projects is something that enhances livability, arguably. So I hope that answers your question a bit. All right. So just to finish off with this ramble through some of the very dynamic and rich literature on urban agriculture, we've got your colleagues, for example, Chiara, talking about social movements, and Matt Reed and I have talked about social movements in terms of internet technology between them, in Bristol, for example. And then, as I was saying just now, urban agriculture networks, particularly alternative food networks, are seen as being very socially innovative, and they can add to regional development in some cases as well. So, there's my case. The case is that urban agriculture is rich in literature, it's diverse, it's very vibrant, and it's coming out at great speed. And actually practice is leading that. It's practice-led, some of this, and so the scholars are running behind the practitioners often, and that maybe that's why it's so dynamic. So, let me just say a few things about why Mark at Bamberg and I have been working together on urban horticulture in particular. And this goes back to my quick gallop through the literature. We think that very few studies have been done on urban horticulture in small and medium scale cities, in provincial cities. And it's at this scale that we're rather familiar with city life at the European level. And Mark's got a very fascinating paper that he's written some years ago where he talks about the idea of rurban, rural and urban. And he's saying that, in many cities, but provincial cities in particular, the porosity between the boundary between the city and the countryside is great. There's a sort of a cultural interdependence going on, but there's also a spatial one, and we'll see examples of that in a moment, where you're seeing facets of life normally associated with the country appearing and thriving and continuing in cities. Also, as I know very well, having worked on the Superb Food Project at Gloucestershire, I'll come back to that in a moment, a lot of these urban agriculture studies are quite technical. How do we grow more food in the city? How can this narrative around social innovation actually be converted into profitability and social enterprise, let's say? How can we get political support for what we're doing? How can we see what we're doing as a kind of a political statement for change? All these things are happening. And again, Mark and I were struck that some of these cultural dimensions that I'll be covering this morning have been missing. So there's another inspiration behind the work. And as I was saying, really this builds on work that we did at CCRI with a consortium of colleagues within European universities, but a number of practitioner networks, including RUAF, across the globe. And if you want to have a look at Superb Food, then here's the website. All of the papers are on there. But that was really interested in how urban and peri-urban food was associated with short food chains, multifunctional land use, and improvements in food waste recycling. Okay, so there's the background and the justification and the rationale, I suppose. So what I'm going to ask today is really to think about the work I've done, the empirical work we've done in Bath and Bamberg, and ask a few questions. So first of all, how does urban horticulture and the culture of urban horticulture, I mean that in two ways, I suppose, the culture of agriculture, the caring for, the rearing and the growing of food, as well as the culture of doing that, how does that shape local identity and community, particularly in Bamberg? How is culture productive or counterproductive to cooperation? And this is, I'd like to say, an important question, because so much of the literature has said, okay, if you do alternative or community-led food, it's going to cost you a fortune to grow the carrots, but it's innovative and it's about cooperation. We're saying in Bamberg, that may not be the case always. It can be counter-cooperative because of the cultural context. And then lastly, what's the role of alternative food networks in renewing cultural meanings and contributing to cultural change? So here's another more hopeful sort of insight into the way that alternative food networks do or may work. And really, what I'm aware of as I go through this exemplar of Bamberg is that it's a really quite untypical example. It's an ideal example. So, I'm conscious of that. And you may well shake your finger at me later and say, well, nowhere is like Bamberg. What a ridiculous case study you offered us. But it does help us to raise the idea of culture, which is my main message this morning, really. And I'm going to introduce four types of different culture linked to urban horticulture in Bamberg. So let me just sort of try and justify why Bath and Bamberg make a good comparison. Well, the first reason is that they're about the same size. They have more or less the same demographic profile. And they also have very similar topography. They're sort of in basins surrounded by hills. This is very important in the context of this morning. They have World Heritage status. Bath for its Georgian architecture and its Roman baths, and for the green sort of ring around the city. That's an important part of it as well. Whereas in Bamberg, they have a medieval town structure, sort of foundation. They have splendid Baroque architecture, and then they have this garden quarter, which is part of the World Heritage status. Here we are, some other similarities, the importance of tourism. And then just moving over to the differences, there are differences, and we have to acknowledge them. Germany is a federal state, which means governance is a very different situation over there compared to our unitary council in Bath. I really want to also quickly raise, I won't spend too much time on this, but the importance of breweries in our study is marked, because the gardeners that we'll be showing in a moment really rely on these small traditional breweries, of which there are plenty in the city and in the district, to sell their produce. It's an old established supply chain, which means local food is widely dispersed in catering establishments in the city. And I think that's slightly different in Bath, where Bath local food is very important as well, but really the idea of the whole of the southwest is in the consciousness of people in Bath who are promoting local food in pubs and restaurants. This is another important consideration. It's not hampering our research, but it's important in the sense that in Germany there is simply more money in the municipal purse.
More euros.
Maybe.
And we could
sort of make comparisons about rich places, poor places. Bamberg is not really a poor city, but then again, nor is Bath. But, Bath is facing huge redundancies. It's already gone through 40% cuts. It's Bath may well be a rich, fancy city with all sorts of ideas of its self-importance and worth and its splendour, but it's still a skin council. The other thing is maybe that the gardens have been there a long time in Bamberg, whereas in Bath, you know, commercial horticulture really disappeared by the 60s. And then I just put in here the burden of Bristol. You know, Bristol is the funky, trendy food city, isn't it? And Bath's just 12 miles away. And it has to sort of distinguish itself and also kind of hook into that and compete with that. Am I doing this right? There we are. Okay, so let's have a quick look at some Bath things. So we've got, I've said this, there's a past history of horticulture, a really rich one actually. They had, you know, they're in an amazing spot. Great weather, great aspects, great slopes, lots and lots of horticulture going on in Bath, particularly in the Victorian period, which is, you know, not a period that's celebrated in the World Heritage story in Bath, the Victorian period. But look at this, Bath is largely self-sufficient till the 1950s. How interesting. Here's what's in the World Heritage status, I mentioned that already, and there's lots of alternative networks in Bath. Transition Bath, for example, Orchard Chair. Here's a plan of the Bath Organic Root Community Garden. There's the Orchard Chair logo. So there's a lot going on the alternative scene, the so-called alternative scene in Bath. And it's so successful, and many spaces are being managed by the alternative networks now, that the city council has even done things like ask some of the networks to draft the new allotment strategy for the city. They're consulting with them regularly on, you know, planning applications, that sort of thing. So that's a very healthy you know, relationship between the alternative networks and the city council. And not just the city council, other public authorities like the health authorities as well. In Bamberg, we've got a different story. There's about 30 to 35 family-owned commercial, I really want to emphasise that, commercial nurseries that have been there since medieval times. They're quite small. They're integral and designated within the World Heritage status. And because of their age and their family traditions, you know, there are these very strong cultural routines that are practiced. There are links to other institutions in the city, for example the council and the church, as we'll see in a moment. The way that they sell their produce is through shops, but actually that's a minor outlet for them. Mainly it's through the breweries, as I was saying, through street markets and particularly direct marketing. We'll have a look about that a bit more in a minute. And there are some particularly local varieties. The cabbage and the potatoes are very, very famous in Bamberg, but also garlic and licorice. And this is a very traditional meal that you would get in one of those breweries. So this is Schäufele, if you know this, Jana. This is like a shoulder of pork baked in the oven with a kind of crispy rind. This is Bamberger Wirsing cabbage, and this is a dumpling. And that's a very, very traditional and very filling and hearty meal that is pretty affordable as well for many people to eat. And here I am interviewing one of the gardeners. So this is just to say what we did in the project funded by the Bavarian Research Alliance. We visited this, each other's cities, Bath and Bamberg, in September 2015 and October. We did a number of interviews with councillors, growers, tourism officials, brewers, etc. And at this point I'm going to leave Bath behind. So I'm just going to say some of the things that came out of the Bath work. So, in fact it came out of the comparative work, but we'll just say this as the last springboard out of Bath. So there are five key things that I'll raise. So there's distinctions between the cities and the reach of local. I said that already, didn't I? Very local and the whole of the southwest. Food, local food is associated with quality in both cities, but for different reasons. And in Bath, it's for high-end gastronomy, you know, the exquisite experience for which Bath has always been famous. And then in Bamberg, it's much more about reliability. This is what I know. And then there are different ways of signifying that quality as well. There's this idea of fraternity, cooperation, and rivalry. We'll go into that in more detail in a minute, but I've tried to explain already that in Bath, there's a lot of cooperation going on between people, within networks like transition bars, for example, between institutions like the alternative people and the authorities. And then there are things happening like, you know, progressive public procurement, where groups of farmers collaborate to try and win public procurement contracts from public authorities that feed people. That's a contrast in Germany, and we'll see that more in a minute. And then there's a role at the state. I said about the state already, right? So let's just leave the state behind for now so I can crack on. Now, so at the start, I was talking about Mark and his idea of Ruhrbund, and maybe that raised a few eyebrows. And what I wanted to just do is to show you this beautiful picture here by Jürgen Schraubner, who took the picture for the World Heritage Centre in Bamberg. And look, here we are. This is the middle of the city, or the very, very edge of the inner city. And you can see, you know, these beautiful old houses, there's all this green space. I mean, that could easily be a village image, really, couldn't it? And then down here, newly off the press, 2017, is the plan for how cities can become green. Weißbuch statt grün, that means green city. And Weißbuch is like the design or the technical manual or other, it's not a manual, but it's a policy document about how do we envisage cities offering, you know, ecological functions now. Because another thing that's said about urban horticulture, almost every paper you read about urban horticulture starts with the line, you know, more than 50% of us live in cities. Actually in Europe, more than 80% of us live in cities. So the Germans have said, right, you know, we recognise this. Number two, we have a rural depopulation problem. So what we need to do is to make sure that cities are livable. And that means not just ecological function, but literally green space. Literally green space. And here are aerial photos of the two traditional garden quarters, and you can see how closely they are together, really, you know, because here's the train line. They're just really next door to each other. So the lower Gärtnerstadt garden quarter and the upper Gärtnerstadt, and you can see just about here these areas, these horticulture areas and glass houses as well. So I said most of the things on this slide about the background to Bamberg. I want to emphasise that there are two quarters because they are rivals. They are formed as fraternities, and there are some really interesting and difficult rivalries that go on between them. But what I also wanted to do is to draw on, you know, some other literature. Parham, is it Sarah or Susan? Susan Parham, I think, at Hertfordshire, writes about food in cities almost from a spatial or planning point of view. And I was captured by what she said about how food space is something that's been developed over centuries as rural green space in the cities. So in a way, my point is that the continuation of this medieval tradition somehow yet chimes in with current thinking around policy making for city life. Here's another diagram that shows you them next door to each other. And, so this is the garden space, and then these are the other parts, really, of the World Heritage Area, and that's really the inner city. And then up here north of the railway station, there's even more peri-urban agriculture going on. So, I think I've said this already, I've covered this already, but I'll just leave it up for a moment. I think I mentioned also already that some of the sales do go into shops, but that's a minority. And people have tried to get into local supermarkets. The other distinction that some German regions have is that supermarkets are regional, or they're smaller than our rather dominant supermarket. So it is occasionally it's slightly easier to get your local food into supermarkets because the quantities don't have to be quite as big and standardised as we need them to be here. Okay, and here's what it looks like in the Gartenstadt. Look at these houses, they're quite low, and they have these big entrances which, carriages and horse-drawn wagons would come in and out of with the vegetables, and the gardens are behind them. So you don't get a sense of the garden at all. When you walk, this is the gardener's quarter. There's no gardens if you're on the street level. But then these doors open and you could go into the courtyard and buy your vegetables there and see the big glass houses and everything behind you. So, in terms of the UNESCO World Heritage designation, let's just emphasise as well that it's very, very central. There are these three aspects I talked about why Bamberg has got cultural world heritage status. One of those three reasons is the gardener's quarter. Bamberg is a town which really relies on tourism. So any idea that the gardener's quarter might be in trouble, for example, through supermarket competition, for example, through changes in consumer habits, as we know them to be here. For example, that these streets are narrow and difficult to get down, and you know, and people might not do their shopping daily anymore by bicycle, they might want to do weekly by car. All of these things are challenges. Another challenge that they share is the idea of an aging farmer population. You know, the average age of many of the gardeners is advanced. So gardeners are saying, right, I want to stop gardening, and I want to sell my space, and maybe want to build a house on it, or I want to sell it for development. And of course the city council is thinking, well, Bamberg is a popular city, it's a growing city, there's a lot of industry and business going on here. You know, 20 hectares of horticulture in the inner city is hugely valuable. So if they're getting their, you know, clutches on that space, that really, really directly threatens the UNESCO designation. So this is suddenly a different story we're talking about here, isn't it? This is about how, you know, these places, which in some ways seem anachronistic, have to be preserved to retain a heritage status around which a massive tourist industry hinges. So, this is our first culture. I promised you four cultures. The first culture today is the culturalization of the garden, of urban horticulture in Bamberg in the gardener's quarter. It's the official culturalization of Bamberg's urban horticulture because that culture is understood as a bundle of practices and habits, spatial structures that are symbolic because of their heritage culture. And down here you can, you know, you can read up about the Gartenstadt in the World Heritage terms. I should say, oh, we'll come to that in a moment. So let's think about the culture of the gardeners. That's our second culture. The first culture was the official culturalization of the space. The second one is the culture of the gardeners. So I was saying that there are very strong family traditions. There's a continuation of and a renewal of the involvement of gardeners in official life in the city. And there's an ongoing involvement of the gardeners in all sorts of festivals and traditions. There's a museum that's been revived recently with help from the World Heritage Centre. And here is the Corpus Christi Festival that the gardeners are very closely associated with. In the gardeners' museum, there's a room that contains all of these kind of church paraphernalia that they carry around at Corpus Christi. So the museum acknowledges not only, you know, a history of gardening, there are tools there, there's a working garden there, there's a house that you can walk around, a traditional gardener's house, but there's also all this other stuff linked to their role in celebrating the Christian calendar of the year. So, the culture of the gardeners is a set of routines and traditions, I'll come back to that reflected in Invisibles in a minute, which shape identities. They shape the identities of the gardeners. But these gardeners, in the main, are rather conservative. So the way that their identity is shaped is by looking backwards into history. And that, as I was saying, doesn't really fit with the way that food consumerism, spatial planning, economic development in cities, how that's thought about so much. There are some exceptions, though, within these fraternities. Let me just give you, I'm conscious that I'm being filmed, so I don't want to sensationalise this, but one of the people we interviewed told us a story about how her mother and father were from rival factions, the upper and the lower gardeners' quarters. And until the late 60s, when they were courting, the father would regularly be beaten by his own fellows in the fraternity because he was trying to court someone from the other fraternity. So, you know, is this our, you know, socially innovative alternative food network picture that we're familiar with? No, it's not. It's a different picture. And part of it's invisible and not reflected because it simply happens. It's part of the routines of the city, it's part of the identity, but it's not an identity that people are being swept along with. You know, it's an old thing. And here you can see, this is a map on a walk that the World Heritage people and others have designed a walking route around the two gardening quarters. And here on their maps, their route finders, you can see the historical boundary between the two. So this boundary between the two fraternities is even officially recognised in footpath maps. But there is this sort of counterculture emerging within the Gardner fraternities because there's this rather weak, you know, integration between them, which is threatening them commercially. So it's all very well saying I'm from this side and you're from that side, but in today's commercial reality that's tricky. So people are saying, how can we begin to trade between each other? How can we support one another? How can we buy things in common to save money through economies of scale? How can we address the commercial threats that not changing poses to us? So an association has been set up, and here's its logo, and it has a very good website, which is all about discovering the gardener's quarter. It's not about protecting old rivalries, it's about collaborating and cooperating, and opening up these hidden cultures and these hidden geographies of Bamberg to visitors. Another good example of this is that people would dearly love, busloads come every day. This is, don't forget, this is part of the World Heritage designation. And people, busloads of tourists come and they want to see the gardens. And the gardeners aren't happy about this because, you know, it would distract them from their work. This is private land. You have to go through their private homes to get to the gardens. You know, this is quite an intrusion. So there's an issue of public access and intrusion, despite the fact that lots of people are desperate to see these places and think them fascinating. So, some of the gardeners have come together in the Interessengemeinschaft, you know, an interest group, a community of practice, I suppose, to try and open up and to break this kind of social you know, separation that is a result of these deep-rooted cultural rivalries. So here's a few quotes, and here we are on the third culture. The third culture is the culture of eating food in Bamberg, consumer culture. So we've had the official culture, we've had the culture of the gardeners, and now we're on the culture of the consumers. As I was saying, unlike in Bath, where local food is fancy food, in Bamberg, local food is reliable, familiar food. We know what we're getting. We know what it's going to be, we know how much it's going to cost, we know it's going to be good. It's not going to surprise us. So that means it's every day and taken for granted. That's quite interesting in the light of what, you know, we've all been studying around local food for years. So, and I think the other thing I want to want to emphasise is the role of breweries, you know, because that dish that I showed you, the Schäuferlein, that's one of many traditional dishes. The place to eat those dishes is in breweries. These breweries are beautiful old buildings where barley is malted in the back room by the brewmaster. You know, the kitchen is in the brew house, next to the brew house. Everything's there. It's a convivial, old-style place that's really nice to sit in, and it's affordable. So there are two quotes I want to just read out. One is about beer. So it has to be said, says this interviewee, that beer is a food for us, a basic form of nourishment, rather like bread or butter or milk. Check that out. And he's not joking, this guy. And part of the implications of that is that when you go to drink beer, you go to the brewery. And when you're at the brewery, there's a whole eating culture in breweries, Portside, if you know all about that, but we won't get into that, there's no time. So, you know, you are taking your nourishment through beer, according to this man. The good place to go is the brewery. And when you're there, you're going to eat this traditional food from local sources. It all adds up very nicely. And here's one of the brewmasters. We try to communicate through the menu that our food is local, but I think that sadly, to many people, it's more important that the food tastes good. I don't want to suggest they don't care, but I don't believe that they think all that deeply about it. So local food in the brewery supply chain is taken for granted. It's an everyday thing. It's nothing special, but it's sort of special, but it's special because we know what we're dealing with. It's not unfamiliar. So, the third culture, a consuming culture of taken for granted local and cheap, relatively cheap, urban food, which is qualitatively reasonable and locally distinctive, and is eaten by locals. In Bath, it's eaten by locals, but particularly it's also eaten by tourists. And we're going to sell it at a high price because what we're trying to market in Bath is exclusive, high quality, great experience. And that's what Bath's been for 300 years. That's what it wants to be. Okay, so now let's introduce the last culture and the alternative food network. So there are alternative food networks in Bamberg too. And many have tried to get involved in growing in the last few years. One of them, I'll give you two examples. One is, and they're very similar names. The first one is the Bamberger Sortengarten, and this is a garden where locally distinctive varieties are grown. So the licorice or the local potato. And people go out of their way to grow in this garden locally distinctive varieties. And the Sortengarten's been established by a range of people from civil society. There's an organic commercial gardener, the one in the picture that I showed you when I was interviewing her. She's also a city council member for the Green Party. I think, you know, just as a quick aside, what we know from people like Kevin Morgan is that, you know, if you want to integrate alternative food networks into municipal thinking, it's good to have political support. And again, you know, another parallel I want to draw here is that in Bamberg, because we've got a long-standing integration gardeners in city institutions, that's possible. Hasn't usually been green, but even so. So we've got innovation happening because a number of gardeners want to break out of this traditional rivalry straitjacket, I suppose. They also see that there's a societal and communal role in strengthening cooperation, and they recognise as well this difficulty about getting people in the gardens, even though that's rather intrusive and disruptive. So the Sortengarten is open, and you can get into it. So let's have a quote from her. We wanted to preserve old varieties of plants and seeds. Many local varieties were developed as a result of the local gardening culture. We managed to save some, but many have been lost. We found old recipes and now organised cooking sessions so that old varieties can be included in dishes and combined with new varieties. So this is kind of also backward looking, isn't it, as well? It's looking back into history, back into old traditional recipes. People are foraging around to try and find evidence of what people were cooking in the old days, and are reviving them so that these old varieties can again feature in people's routine eating. And then there's another one, the Selbstkantergarten, very similar name to the Sortengarten, but the Selbstkantergarten is a garden where people kind of It's a bit like an allotment in a way. So this is a commercial gardening space, but the gardener's given it up. And the transition network in Bamberg approached the gardener and said, can we please rent this land? And we'll pay you for the space. But by the way, we don't really know what we're doing because we aren't commercial gardeners and we haven't had land before, for example. So could you please help us? We'll pay you. And here's a cropping schema for the space. So the commercial gardener will say, I'd be delighted to help you divide up your land into different plots and then to consider what kind of crops you want to grow depending on are you feeding just your family and you want to have minimum maintenance issues, or do you want to sell to some other community scheme, or whatever you want to do. So this is beginning to be interesting as well, because we've got this alternative network, the transition network, who, by the way, have got their own culture. There's almost a 4.5 culture in here, but we'll leave that for another day, because in talking to the transition network, they have a kind of routine of dealing with you and of talking with you that is quite ritualistic. I'd say, ooh, I'm alive on YouTube. It's a very positive thing. But it is a different cultural experience talking to them compared to, let's say, interviewing a gardener, which is something that we'd be much more familiar with, maybe. So what we're seeing now is a coming together of two cultures. There's our fourth culture, the new culture, the alternative food network, who are saying, we have some normative or political or ideological interest in food in the city. And that's a different one from the other cultures that have gone before. And in this culture, we see people having a strong emphasis on learning and sharing knowledge and practice through social events and talks. All the things we're quite familiar with in this country with alternative food networks. And look how many people there are, how many people are involved in using this land. This is another thing we're familiar with from urban agriculture as a social pastime or an enterprise. It's very labour intensive, or it's simply social, depending on your point of view. Now, here's the case I want to make for this culture. So it's an alternative, maybe a political or an ideological type of culture. It's framed by transition in this case, but it is associated with cooperation. Not only cooperation within the group, but cooperation with the commercial gardeners, who are now, for money, of course, the gardener's being paid, but this is an important step, I think, in thinking through how the culture of horticulture persists. We talked about all those pressures on place, the pressures on succession. Maybe we need to think quite openly and reflexively about the future of who and how those spaces are managed, not just that they must be retained. So I'm nearly at the end now. So there's two more slides. One is that, we're all scholars, so we're interested in studying this kind of stuff. So I'll just say a few words there. So I've said already, haven't I, that I think, personally, I hope I've convinced you, that social cultural dimensions can really supplement, not replace, but really supplement some of that more technical political stuff that we have heard about and is really exciting us from other colleagues. And simply put, these perspectives give us more geographies of urban agriculture and urban horticulture, which have been hidden. Okay, I think also that, when we think about the stuff, the familiar stuff, the social innovation, the self-provisioning, and the spatial differentiation that I touched upon in the literature slide around urban agriculture, I've said already it was, this overlooking of small spaces, of small cities, is an omission, because they do have often this porosity with the countryside, this interaction, culturally I'm speaking now, as well as functionally, with the countryside. And also, in the case of Bath, which we haven't spent too long talking about, there is a very, very dominant narrative about the identity of the city. And this sociocultural insight can challenge some of that. And in terms of theory, Mark and I have been really chewing around a bit. We haven't we haven't gone too far down this route, but this is the route we've set ourselves on. We're thinking about people like Armin Nasahi, who's a German sociologist based at Munich University. And he talks about cultures as being kind of schemes or scripts for acting and producing meanings. And I think, you know, this is something that could apply easily to urban agriculture and urban horticulture, both in the conventional sense and in the alternative sense. And I've tried to suggest that the future of urban horticulture in Bamberg, at least, could be partly about preserving routines and identities, or is it maybe better to open up the challenge and have those routines and traditions and have new collaborations across them? Some of that takes us also to Niklas Luhmann, who talks about social systems and the way that they communicate with each other. So, you know, that could be a way for us. That's the way that Mark and I will now begin to think about culture in urban horticulture. But if you have any ideas or warnings or encouragements around how Luhmann's theory of social systems might illustrate some of these insights, let me know. But I'll just highlight this last sentence. Food can be an arena of a city's cultural dynamics and the other way around. So, you know, food is culture. Agriculture is culture of a sort. But it also, food and food production informs the culture, the developing culture of the city. And so it should, given all of our sustainability and resilient interests. So, here we are at the end. I identified four types of culture. There's the official culturalization, kind of the imposition of what culture means within the World Heritage Framework. There was the traditional culture of the gardeners, involved in the Corpus Christi traditions and all of that stuff about rivalries that I mentioned. There's the consumption culture of the residents, linked to familiarity, but changing. And then there's a new culture that's being introduced by AFNs. You know, the idea that we can reach across cultural divides, but also that the transition network, in this case, has its own kind of cultural way of doing things. And this is part of the revival, or the revivification of culture in the city. What that also means, I think, going back to Luhmann, is that horticulture in Bamberg is not just the material landscape of the productive areas, but it's part of the symbolic identity of the place. You know, its place names, its architecture, and the whole quarter of the city. Maintaining horticulture, I've said already, haven't I, really, is a high-stakes preoccupation that engages different levels of official engagement. And they don't all agree, of course. And then, because of the richness of the tradition, we also see it as a burden because of the rivalries and the lifestyles. But also, you know, the reaching back into the old recipes and the language and the varieties, the vegetable varieties, has become an exciting new thing for some people. But what I've tried to say is that in many cases, in most cases, unlike the familiar picture here, what we're not really seeing in Bamberg is that urban agriculture is an innovation. It's, in fact, a deeply rooted cultural practice. And those practices have really inhibited innovation and cooperation until quite recently. And here's my last point. So much of the AFN literature, the Goodman, Dupuy Goodman book is a brilliant, brilliant example of this, says AFNs aren't reflexive enough. My case here, our case, Mark's case and my case, is that in this case study, the AFN has stimulated reflexivity in other systems. So we're saying, okay, we don't dispute the Goodman et al. Case, we agree with it. But a new insight is that the AFN has stimulated reflexivity in otherwise non-reflexive, you know, the traditional guard of fraternities, the non-cooperative, the stuck in the past group. And I think that maybe is perhaps a good new point I'd like to emphasize today. That's it. Thank you.